First time I came to the stadium was way back when it was being built, and happened to play a match across. The introduction I got, they forgot about my true love, which is cricket, and I've been playing cricket since I was age of 5. My first coach was Mr. Bapu Nadkarni. We were very lucky, we were coached by test cricketers, unlike today where you hardly see the test cricketers. Maybe you'll run after them and get their autographs, and people like Marcus will have them on display today. But we were very fortunate. I had a chance to be coached by Bapu Nadkarni, and my second coach at Tersis was with the great Vinu Mankad. I don't think Vinu Mankad is very fond of me. Firstly, I knew nothing about Gujarati. And secondly, he didn't study much. I don't know whether you know much about Vinu Mankad as well, one of the greatest legends of our game. But he would be fond of people and not fond of people, and that's it. And I'll tell you a story which I think you will appreciate. He was very fond of Gavaskar, and Gavaskar and his son Rahul were also very close to each other. So poor Vinu was not too well. He was at home or in a small nursing home somewhere in Thakur Dwar side. That's where he stayed. Very simple people. And he was lying in bed waiting for somebody to come and talk to him. So these two boys came and they wanted to just talk cricket. So after some time of, you know, maybe 1 hour, 2 hours, both the boys said, "Sir, we have to go and study. We're going back to college, or we have to collect some books." And Vinu Mankad told both the boys, "Please study. See, I'm almost illiterate. I don't know what to do with my time today. I'm waiting for someone to come and speak to me because I can't even read the newspaper. I don't enjoy that." So you can imagine where we have progressed today, not only as cricketers but as human beings. You have an icon of cricket, a legend, who gives a statement to Sunny and his own son that please study. Today you have, in fact, there's a selection going on for, I thought I was coming for that but I got waylaid here, for the IPL team for the Rajasthan Royals. I don't know how many of you know that, but a close friend of mine, Zubin, said that I'm going to be at the ground. So I said, then should I carry my kit along? So I said, look, so many things I've done to try and put my hand up for any international or famous team, but I've not even come in the picture. Nevertheless, the fact is I still play cricket today. I played a game on the 2 days back at the Wankhede. It was a fun game, but I still played cricket and I still continue to play. I'm longing to play the next match. The only thing I share with Sachin Tendulkar today is that I've got a tennis elbow, but I won't get it operated, that's for sure. So anyway, let me tell you another story. I'm supposed to talk about cricket and how it is with the mind. I'll talk about it very little, but we've got such a mixed audience. Let me tell you some stories in my life where I came one-on-one with cricketers who were not even great at that time, but I knew that they would be great. And I'll tell you a few of such incidences in my life, and then you can relate the two, how the mind tends to notice people who might play for India or play as close as getting to India. One such story is actually of Amol Mojumdar, and he wouldn't know this because he was just 11 or 12 at that age. He must have attended one of these so-called sessions where I was invited to speak to a whole crowd of youngsters. And these youngsters were brought in by their parents, mom and dad, or probably just their mom or dad. And in fact, after my talk, which was maybe half an hour, 40 minutes or something, and Amol's dad came up to me and said, "I don't know how you managed to play so much of cricket, and you're a doctor and you're a professor and you're at KM Hospital and you're a neurosurgeon." So I said, "Look, I think the essence is focus. So I don't know how many kids there are here in the audience, but focus is not not taking drink or, you know, doing this or doing that. Focus is for the present. When a batsman faces a bowler, he has to focus on that ball. At that split second, if he has lost his focus, he might think of the previous ball, or he might think of a shot that he played and he didn't want to play that shot, or he might think of something going on in the background, which often happens, or there's somebody talking in the slip cordon and he gets distracted. So it's this focus. If you look at any religious book as well, I don't know how much of you have read about Buddha's teachings, but Buddha says, be still, be quiet, because that's the only time you can appreciate what's happening around you. If you're the one making all the noise, like I'm speaking right now, I don't know what the hell is going on over here. You know, so these things are critical things for the mind, and unfortunately our cricketers don't realize this. I'm not a big fan of anyone who, you know, pumps his fist and does that, but it looks great to the crowd, I'm sure. You had a John McEnroe in tennis as well, and you have a couple of youngsters today, and I think the Indian captain also used to be considered as one of these so-called voracious kind of cricketers, where you can, you know, see the emotion on their faces. I think it's good for the media for sure. I don't know whether it's great for the sport. The thing is, you lose your focus. When you try and do something, I can't imagine even me running into a crease and not grounding my bat. I won't want to mention which cricketer did this in this recently going on or concluded test match, because we're looking down the barrel. I think we were 8 wickets down, right? So that's horrible. I'm sure I could last 5 days in a test match. Even today, I may not score more than 20 runs. And I'm sure Marcus would tell a story where I was on the crease. I think I'll tell it for him today. I was batting on the crease. And Sishir Hatangadi played for Bombay, opening batsman. I used to open also. We were batting, and I may have played maybe 20 overs, game 45 over game, one of these A-team matches. We had Vengsarkar, we had a lot of people playing for us at Bombay Gym. And Shishi said, hit the bloody ball, man. What are you just playing? Tuku, tuku, tuku. There's so much batting lineup. And I said, okay, look, the wicket is playing funny. Don't think it's a very, you know, and we get a bit of dew at Bombay Gym. So the wicket was playing a little bit. But he said, you hit out. So I was 32 or something, I got out. And soon enough, we collapsed and we had 15 overs to spare. Can you imagine 15 overs? You go all out in 30 or 34 overs, and Marcus will know. He was the umpire, in fact. And he heard Shishi pounding me and telling me, please get out, you know. So I've written a small article, which was actually published in the Gyle Shield Review, or the Harry Shield Review, where I've said that I tend to stay on the wicket all the time. In fact, Marcus has already warned me. He's got a couple of cards and things that I can go on and on, even here, entertaining all of you and talking about today's function, and I won't know the time. And that's probably because I'm a neurosurgeon. A 10-hour surgery is nothing. I mean, for us, it's like everyday work. I remember going to the commissioner's office and saying that, look, there are riots on and we need this and we need that. And he said, look, my cops cannot take 10 hours duty. They have duty, they are abbreviated with lunch, tea and snacks. I said, I should speak to them then. I should tell them that, look, there are other professions where are just as critical, but you might have to change your habits of eating and drinking. So again, it boils down to how you can